This episode has been brought to you by our super generous supporters on Patreon. Not too long ago, computers were people. They were math wizards and savants, people with a natural talent for numbers. Not only did they do the calculations and computations that machines do for us now, but their work directly led to the invention of the computer as we know it today. But much of their contributions to the field of computer science went unnoticed during their lifetime, because they were women. Good Stuff producer Matt Weber tells the story of Jean Bartik, one of the first human computers that made the first fully functional digital computer possible. Take it away, Matt. Don't take my computer. Just continue on with this video. Thank you.
Early on, Jean Jennings Bartik had shown a remarkable aptitude for mathematics. But instead of becoming a teacher like her mother and grandmother before her, Bartik had loftier goals. She wanted to be a human computer. Although most math-oriented positions at the time were the exclusive domain of men, World War II had opened up opportunities for women that only a few years before seemed unattainable. And so Bartik joined a squad of human computers at the Moore School at the University of Pennsylvania. Since this type of work was considered clerical work, most of Bartik's colleagues were women. And more than ever, these female computers were integral to the war effort. To accurately shoot an artillery shell depended on a number of factors, including angle of fire, range to target, wind speed, and weather conditions. Without a personal computer on hand to calculate these ballistic trajectories, a soldier couldn't be expected to do the correct math off the top of his head in the heat of battle, so they depended on firing tables. Firing tables were essentially sets of pre-calculated trajectories that soldiers could reference so they could quickly fire upon their target given almost any circumstance. Each table comprised around 1,000 trajectories, each one hand-calculated by a human computer. But even with the mathematical strength displayed by Bartik and her colleagues, the US military wanted a way to calculate these trajectories even faster. That's when John Malkley and J. Presper Eckert came up with the idea of building an electronic digital computer. Theoretically, it would be able to calculate firing tables at an order of magnitude faster than any human computer. This machine was called ENIAC. Weighing close to 50 tons and taking up as much space as an entire house, ENIAC was one of the very earliest fully functional digital computers. Even though it operated with over 17,000 vacuum tubes and not transistors like today's computers, ENIAC is still one of the direct ancestors of all the computers we see today. When it first debuted, ENIAC revolutionized the kind of calculations we could feasibly do and drastically reduced the time it took to do them. In just 30 seconds, ENIAC could complete more calculations than Jean Bartik could in 30 hours. But that didn't mean she was out of a job. ENIAC was designed to be programmable. Instead of focusing on just one task, ENIAC could be modified to calculate a whole host of different numerical problems. But programming a computer back then wasn't like programming today. The program had to be drafted on paper by hand before the electromechanical innards of the machine were physically manipulated to integrate the problem and make the proper computations possible. And the people best suited to program a digital computer were the human computers. Malkley and Eckert recruited Bartik and five other women to program ENIAC, essentially making them some of the earliest digital computer programmers. They gained an intimate knowledge of the inner workings of ENIAC because they often had to physically crawl inside of the machine to work out bugs and replace blown tubes. As primitive as this might seem, Bartik and her colleagues basically invented the discipline of computer programming. The techniques they developed laid the foundation for almost all computer programming that came afterward. By the time ENIAC was built and ready to go, World War II was over. But that didn't mean it was obsolete, because a whole new war was just beginning. In the desert of New Mexico, researchers at Los Alamos National Laboratory soon seized upon the potential of ENIAC, and it was reprogrammed to compute the parameters necessary to make the most powerful weapon in all of human history, the hydrogen bomb. After the ENIAC project was over, Jean Bartik went on to help develop the next generation of digital computers. But soon her career as a computer programmer hit an impasse. As the field of computer programming grew and the pay became more lucrative, more men became interested in it, pushing the early women pioneers out of the field. Not only was Bartik replaced by the machines she helped develop, she was being denied entry into a field she largely helped establish. Her team's role in the creation of ENIAC was largely ignored. Even photos showing them working on the machine were disregarded. Since they were women, many assumed they were just models posing in front of the machine, not the team responsible for programming it. In the past 30 years, the computer industry has exploded. Despite the dramatic increase in computer science-related jobs, women graduating with a degree in computer science has plummeted to 18% from a high of 37% in 1984. Much of this gender gap can be attributed to the popular depiction of computer programming as a profession almost exclusively held by men. A 2015 study from Accenture Research has shown that girls are much more likely to show an interest in computer science if introduced to the subject by a female role model. and it hasn't helped that for decades, role models like Jean Bartik have gone unrecognized. This gender gap has negative consequences on the US economy as well, because the supply of computer science majors graduating each year cannot keep up with the staggering growth of computer-related jobs in the US, companies are left with a personnel shortfall that they can never completely make up for. Cutting out half the population from an entire field of expertise only compounds the problem. Jean Bartik spent much of her later years advocating for the inclusion of women in computer science and technology, but she didn't gain wide recognition for her work on the first digital computers until shortly before her death in 2011. Today, our computers are largely invisible, hidden within our cars, TVs, and our pockets. And a lot of the devices we use, we don't even think of as computers. We take them for granted. But behind every device is software, using principles developed by a group of human computers who themselves were largely invisible and taken for granted. But like the firing tables Jean Bartik worked on in the beginning of her career, the downward trajectory of women in computer science is a numerical problem. But in this case, the quickest solution will be achieved not by machines, but by who the next generation of human computers turns out to be.
So, what do you think? How can we close the gender gap in computer science, or for that matter, the gender gap in STEM careers in general? Let us know in the comments. Don't forget to like and subscribe and share this video. Special thank you to our Patreon subscribers for making this episode of The Good Stuff possible. Without Patreon, the good stuff just wouldn't happen. So if you'd like to help out, head on over to our Patreon page and support the show. Thanks for watching.